everybody, welcome to another episode of Let's Play. I'm here with Chris from Lords of War Games and Hobbies.
How's it going, guys?
And we are doing a Let's Play by request. So today, we're going to run through and show you guys how to play Malifaux. This is something that people had written on a lot about, and basically the reasoning was that Malifaux is a game that, unlike most miniature games, doesn't use dice. And so if you're not familiar with the system, some of the videos that I would make would be confusing to watch because the core mechanics aren't really similar to anything currently sort of popularly on the market. So by request, we're going to do a Let's Play today using the new M2E, so Malifaux 2nd Edition starter set. Now this comes with two crews. You get a Neverborn crew and a Guild crew. And all of the figures in that crew are also mercenaries. So no matter what faction you want to play in the future, this box set, you can use those models in them pretty much unilaterally. Everybody can be hired by any faction.
Yeah, that was a really smart move by them.
Yeah. And you also get starting crews, completely led by henchmen, for the Neverborn and for the Guild. So either one of those two crews can be hired, basically. And if you wanted to play them as a single crew, you could take two of the Guild guys, stick them in the Neverborn, or two of the Neverborn, stick them in the Guild, and away you go.
Yep.
So we're going to go through and play the five missions, and this is going to be a Let's Play in two parts. The five missions from the Quick Start rules basically take you through, and you can follow us along, learning the basic mechanics of the game. So without further ado, we're going to go through the basics, teach you sort of the anatomy of a card, and then we're going to jump into the first scenario. So here it is, the M2E Malifaux starter sets and all of its pretty contents. That leads us to the first part of this book, right here. This is the Quick Start Rules book and what you need to play. So we've got models. There are four Guild models, all painted by Chris right here, and four Neverborn models painted by me. We've got the stat cards. These are all the cards, all the rules for everybody, plus two upgrade cards there in the back. A couple tape measures. You get some neato little purple and red tape measures. For measuring all your movements and stuff during the game. You get some rules, which is what I'm reading out of right now. Fate decks, you get a nice themed one for both the Guild here on the left and the Neverborn on the right. Then you've got a terrain and a table. Now that's not provided in this box, but you can play Malifaux on any surface. We just set up a little 1 foot square here for our first encounter. A hallway stacked with boxes somewhere deep in the bowels of the asylum. That takes us to the basics. First of all, we have a fate deck. Every player has their own 54 card poker deck that you will use to play Malifaux. So this right here is the Neverborn one that comes in the box set. And it has four different suits in it and two jokers. Now the suits are rams, clubs that are tomes, sorry, hearts would be rams, clubs would be tomes, spades are crows, little feathers, diamonds are masks. A jack is valued 11, a queen at 12, and a king at 13, and aces, of course, 1. Now you also have a black and a red joker. A red joker is a value of 14 and can be any suit it wants to be. The black joker is a value of 0 and is no suit. There's more rules for those, they'll be printed on them, and also later on here as we go through the rules for the game. So during a game, players will draw cards from the deck and put them in their cards, in their hands. These cards are kept secret from your opponent. Usually you have a hand of six, unless you have special rules that dictate otherwise. So there's six cards. If a player's deck ever runs out of cards, the player simply shuffles their discard pile and creates a new deck. Be sure to shuffle your new decks before using them, because otherwise they wouldn't be. Measuring in Malifaux. Models in Malifaux have a lot of freedom to move about. When a model moves, it has a set distance it can travel, and tape measure is used to measure the distance it can go. Likewise, distance must be measured when a model takes any kind of action, like shooting, targeting with a spell, or whatever, to make sure that you're in range. All models will be mounted on a round plastic base, and base sizes are actually marked on their cards. So down in this right-hand corner here, this guy's on a 30mm base. And you would not want to mount them on a base that's a different size than what they come with, because it is impactful to the game. All measurements are from closest point to closest point on a base, and you can measure anything at any time. So it's usually called pre-measuring. You do not have to do it when you declare an action. You can do it during or partway through or anytime during an action. So pre-measuring is absolutely fine. So the stat cards themselves. This is a Blood Wretch. He's one of the asylum inmates in this story. And we're going to go through his stats. Number one there, that's his name, the name of the model. Number two is his faction. So the number two there, it's usually a little symbol. This is the Neverborn symbol in purple. Number three, characteristics. So all of the characteristics are usually tag words. So my Blood Wretch, for instance, is a minion. He's living, and he's rare too. And all of those have special rules. We'll go through them later, but for instance, minion is sort of his class. Living is what can affect him. He can be a construct or dead, undead, or whatever as well. Mercenary is what allows him to be hired by their crews. And then rare means that you can only have two of them, up to the rare number in your faction.
Also, the keyword Nephilim can sometimes
factor into. That's right, be key as well. That's right, rules. So all of those characteristics can basically be important throughout the game. Then we've got Soulstone Cost up there in the corner, so he's worth 5 Soulstones. If you were to take him as part of your crew, you usually have a Soulstone pool that you would hire from. So let's say 20 stones, he would reduce your crew or your pool by 5 to recruit him. Now, if you were going to take him as a mercenary in another faction, it costs an extra Soulstone, so his cost would go up by 1 to do so. Then we have Statistics. These numbers represent the character's physical and mental strengths. Each will be explained in more detail later. Death statistics the most important during the first game. That's going to be this one right here, the very first one, which is a 6. Later on, we've got willpower, wounds, walk, their charge, and their height in inches. Then we have their abilities. So these are special abilities. They're always considered to be on, which means that they're usually things you don't activate by doing actions. They're just sort of, passive things that are always happening. So for instance, the Bloodwretch, he has Frenzied Charge. It gets a plus to attack flips for any attacks generates due to a charge action. On the prowl, after killing an enemy model, he gets to heal 2 damage. And Thick Skin, this model can ignore damage from any kind of pulse effects, which will be important later on with the guys in his crew. And then we've got abilities. Sorry, attack actions, which is the next side back here on the other side of the card. There's usually a little bracket. That's how many actions it takes to do it. Its name, and then it's got what kind of attack it is. So it's either melee, casting, or shoot ability. And that's a stat number next to it. So whatever that skill level is the number. What you use to resist it. So when you attack somebody with it, that's the stat they would use to resist, in this case, defense. Its range, which will either have a gun or a claw or nothing next to it. If it has nothing, then it's neither an attack or a shoot action. If it's a claw, it's a melee attack. If it's a gun, it's a shooting attack, and various different abilities and stuff can be sort of procced off that. And then finally, it's damage for that attack, which is target suffers 2, 3, 5. That'll be explained later, but that's his damage track of how much potential damage he can do every time he hits you. Then we have tactical actions. These are actions a model may take that aren't usually resisted by another model, so things that it's like skills but has to spend actions to do. So the Bloodwretch here has the Rage builds. For the rest of the activation, this model attacks deal +1 damage. And when this model deals damage with an attack, it can draw 2 cards and discard 1, which is super handy. So you can get your hand back basically through them. And then finally, like I said earlier, base size down in the corner there, he's on a 30 mil base. Last most important thing for your basic rules is line of sight. If one of your models wishes to attack an enemy model, it must always have line of sight unless otherwise stated. It's an imaginary line drawn from one model to another. It's used to represent whether the model can see each other. You can't attack what you can't see. So line of sight is drawn from anywhere in attacking model's base to anywhere in the defending model's base. However, if the line crosses over terrain, which has a height equal to the greater of the height of both the attacking and defending models, then it's blocked. So for instance, if we had an orderly here and an orderly here, oops, let's go like that. There we go. And we had a Bloodwretch here. He could draw an imaginary line, whoop, between him and this orderly, but this one right here, because this is 2 inches or more tall, well, now it is, whoop, there you go. Height 2 terrain. He cannot draw that imaginary line over to the other orderly and therefore can't see it. So in that little diagram, that's how line of sight would be blocked. A very important step in setting up a game of Malifaux usually is to define terrain. That's where you and your opponent will agree on what the height of things are, and that means that there are no surprises when you're pre-measuring. You always know if you can hide behind something or not. And now finally we get to the encounters, so let the games begin. You grab a friend, and you get to throw some of your toys around. So in the following section, as we go through each of the encounters, you're going to see the models that we're going to use, what new rules get introduced each time, how to set it up, and then whatever special rules there are for the encounters. People learn different ways, and the design sort of these encounters is they layer in new rules each time. So this is the plan. We're going to go through all 5 of these over the course of these 2 episodes. So the first 3 we're going to be doing today. Let's take a look. All right, so now that you've learned the basics and walked through the box set and its contents, we're doing encounter number 1, Hallway Rumble. Basically, the inmates are loose in the asylum, and one of the orderlies is trying to chase down one of the Bloodwretches and get him back into his cell. We're going to learn the basics of damage, attack and defense flips, and opposed flipping, basically in duels, and how you knock someone out of the game. So let's do that, and you guys can learn how to damage someone in Malifaux. So encounter number 1, Hallway Rumble. The patients are getting restless, this kind of restless that grows fangs and claws and comes howling at you in the night. So player 1 gets 1 Bloodwretch, it's going to be me, and I get to put him, whoop, in the hallway. Now player 2 gets 1 orderly, it's going to be Chris who gets to grab an orderly. I think Hansy over there is
he's definitely the one.
All right, he's like, I don't really want to touch you, buddy. So the new rules. First thing we're going to do is we're going to learn about how to start a turn. So each player simply draws 6 cards from their deck into their hands. Then each player will flip over the top card of their deck. The player with the higher card chooses to go first or second. It's called a flipping for initiative, and we reflip in the case of a tie. So for the sake of the intro, I'm going to open hand my deck. Chris is going to pretend not to look, and he's going to close hand his deck, so I don't know what he has. Now we flip for initiative, and that means we're going to both flip our top card, because he's going first. I got a 12, you got a 1, so that means I get to choose first or second, and obviously I will go first. So now we're going to learn about attacking. In this encounter, the orderlies and some of the inmates are having a bit of a squabble, so they're starting right in the action with how to perform an attack. Attack action looks like this, and can be found on the back of the model stat card. So for your orderly, whoop. It'll be on the back right here. And for my Blood Wretch, it's going to be right here in Human Claws. So, melee 6, defense, resist, and then range 1 inch. Target suffers 2, 3, 5 damage. So let's go through this action one piece at a time. So first of all, the action's name. The one will be explained later. Melee, this is an abbreviation for melee, and the number 6 represents how good the Blood Wretch is in melee. The number will be added to a random card flipped from the deck, or played from my hand, so to determine whether the Blood Wretch hits or not. A resist, this is a abbreviation of resist and indicates the stat the defender will use to try and save itself. In this case, resist is defense, and you will of course flip to see what he gets as his total as well. Range is 1 inch, and then finally the attack deals 2, 3, 5 damage if it hits. When the Blood Wretch attacks, both it and the orderly flip a card from the top of their respective flight decks, and then add their totals. So, I got a 6.
8.
You got an 8, so what is your defense?
I'm adding 5 to that.
All right, I'm 13. Adding 6 to mine, which makes it a 12. Now we've got my total, which is 12 to your 13.
Yep.
Once the both starting duels have been determined, the model which is currently losing has the opportunity to cheat fate. When the model cheat fate, it places a card from its hand on top of the card that came out. So if I want to win this one, I need to cheat a higher card in. So I'm going to put down this 11 of crows. And because I'm losing, I have to do it first. Now, at 11 of clubs, take my total to 17. And the loser now has the opportunity to cheat fate.
You got me.
I gotcha, so I'm gonna hit you. So if the defender wins, the attack misses, nothing happens. If the attacker wins, it deals damage to the defender. To do this, the attacker flips another card from the top of its fate deck and compares it to the following chart. So let's see what happens here. 6. So 6 is going to be a moderate amount of damage. Inhuman Claws is damage 2, 3, 5. And that means weak, moderate, and severe. So because I got moderate, that's going to be a total of 3 damage. The cards in the fate deck will also just say the word, so you don't necessarily have to use the chart. So it says moderate here. If I was using just a regular deck of cards, I'd have to look it up on the chart, but here it's just gonna tell me I'm using the middle value. So now you're gonna mark that 3 damage on your guy. You've got 6 total, so 3 left. So now we just alternate making attacks until one of us wins. That's the rest of the scenario. I've started a fight and you get a chance to hit me back. So you just go and swing back at me. So this will be your melee stat. What's your melee
medical
called?
Medical instruments.
Medical instruments.
5.
His medical instruments are these meat hooks he's got right here. Look at the guy's hands. That's just terrifying. If you ever talk to a police officer when they're wearing the black plastic gloves, you know something's gone terribly wrong in your life. You've made poor life choices. So we both flip. You're gonna be adding 6.
Oh, 13.
Okay, so that's 19. My defense on my Blood Wretch is 6, so I got a 17. And so that means you're gonna win this one because I do not have any cards with a cheat higher. So now you're gonna flip for damage again, and we'll see if you get a weak, a moderate, or a severe. Weak, all right, so weak damage on you with medical instruments is?
2.
So I'm gonna take 2 damage on my stat card. All right, so 2 damage for me now, meaning I also have 3 left because I only have 5 total. I need to swing back now. Let's see if I can hit you. Melee 6 plus 13 is 19. Oh, to 4. Do you want to try and cheat it?
No.
Because you are currently losing. You got nothing to cheat it with? All right, so do I get a weak, a moderate, or a severe damage? If I get a moderate here, I'll kill you. Nope, it's weak, and that's going to mean that you survive. 1 left, and you get to swing back. See if you can hit me.
Reckless Fury.
Oh, 11. 11. So I have a 14 total. You have a 17 total. I do not have the ability to cheat any higher than that, which means you'll hit me again.
Damage high.
I'm dead. Moderate damage is 3, and that's going to knock out the Blood Wretch, and the orderly wins the game. All right, so here we go. Encounter number 2, recreation. So now that the inmates are actually out of their cells, it's going to be 2 orderlies taking on 2 Blood Wretches, and we're going to put some more advanced stuff in, like maneuvering, walking around, and some of the general actions that all the models can do in Malifaux. Encounter 2, recreation. They've broken free! Restraints! We need more restraints! So in this game, the models used are 2 Blood Wretches and 2 orderlies. And the new rules we're going to introduce this time in this encounter, we're broken free and running around the asylum. So we're going to introduce movement, and that's going to be the basic action in the game, which is a walk. So every model has access to an action. It's not listed in their card. And it is this stat right here, the WK, 6 inches in this case. And it's called the one walk action. Now one is how many actions it takes, and it gets to move up to its walk stat in inches. A model does not have to move its entire walk when it takes a walk action. To move a model, measure to the point of the base closest to where you want it to be. So for this instance, if I wanted this blood arch to move 6 inches, I could move them in increments of 2 if I wanted. So I could say, hey, let's go 2 inches, 2 inches, and 2 inches, and then be done. And because I can pre-measure everything, I can tell where I'm gonna end up at the end of my day. Model can't move through other models, however, so if this model was standing here, I would have to go around him to get to where I wanna be. And of course, I can't move through impassable terrain, so I can't walk through walls, so I'd have to go around this wall or around this tree instead of going through it. Now, the next thing we're gonna talk about is activations. When a player basically takes turns, when it's his turn, activating a model with his opponent. When a model activates, it gets 2 action points, and each action point represents one thing they can do during their activation. All actions have a AP value. So for example, the orderly has medical instruments as an attack, and it costs 1 there in brackets. Or emergency surgery, which is a 2 thing. So it can spend its entire turn healing 2 damage on a model within 6, or can take 1 of its 2 actions to take a swing at someone with medical instruments. Now, after the first player activates a model and completes any actions that model will be taking and using its AP, the second player will then activate a model, and it goes back and forth until all the models on the table have been activated, in which case we flip for a new turn. We recommend when we play the game is that you flip a card sideways. We're legally not allowed to say tap, but if you were to tap it like this, it wouldn't be the same thing. If you're gonna turn it sideways.
Please turn the card
sideways. That's right, please turn the card sideways and you'll know it's activated, and that will let you keep track of which ones have gone and which ones haven't. If one side has less models than the other, you just keep activating models until you have none left, in which case the turn ends and you would flip for initiative to see who goes first again. Now, one important thing is at the end of a turn, you replenish your hand. So once everyone's activated, you can replenish and draw back up to 6, so that you have 6 cards in your hand. That lets you have a fresh, if you've cheated a whole bunch, hand of cards for every single game round. For the setup for this one, we're gonna be playing on an 18-inch table, and we have 6-inch deployment and 2 pieces of impassable scenery here. So this handy-dandy little set of trees and this fountain, it's basically going to be taking place in the grounds of the asylum, and neither player is allowed to set up past 6 inches, so we get to take it in turns. We'd flip to see who'd go first. We'd place our models 6 inches, the other person would place theirs, so Chris has kindly gone first. I'm going to go second and put my asylum mates over here, and then we will flip for initiative and draw hands. Well, sorry, draw hands, flip for initiative, and see who goes first. So our hands are drawn. We'll be flipping for initiative now. In this scenario, it's all about the damage. The first guy to kill an enemy model will win the game. So let's flip right now and see who's going first. 3, 7, so you get the high flip, which means you can pick a model to activate first. And remember, it is back and forth activation, so Chris will get 1 guy who can go. He gets 2 AP, and he can spend it on walking and making melee actions. Picking this orderly, he's gonna make a walk 6. Action, yep, which is 1 AP.
Right to here.
And then he's got an AP left.
Yep. I'll just move up to here, which is just outside your reach.
Okay, and be done. All right, I'm gonna activate this blood wretch, and he is going to move into here with his first AP as a walk, and his second AP, he's gonna swing on you.
All right, so I'm melee 6 with my inhuman claws, your defense 5.
Yep.
Let's see who hits. I get a 16 total by flipping a 10 of masks.
15.
15 with a 10 of rams. Would you like to cheat?
I would, since I'm a cheater.
All right, and he cheats in with an 11, and that puts you at a 16, but that doesn't actually win, that just ties me. So true. I'll cheat back with a 12, and win. So now I've hit you, so let's see if I get weak, moderate, or severe damage. It's going to be severe, and severe damage from him is 5.
Whew.
So you get 5 points, you have 1 left on that orderly. Back over to you, you can activate a guy. So now what other actions do you have on your card besides medical instruments?
So since these guys are kind of doctors,
kind of doctors. They went to horse doctor in school.
They can perform emergency surgeries only.
Back into war, the war of northern aggression, I learned how to cut off a leg. So what's he going to do? He's going to do some emergency surgery. So for 2 actions, that's all of his actions he has. A model within 6 can get back 2 life.
2 life, and I'm going to do that so he doesn't bite the dust.
All right, so it puts you back up from 5 damage to 3 damage. Now you have 3 left. All right, well, I think I can still finish you off. If I get moderate damage on you, I can kill you. So I'm gonna spend 1 AP to walk in with this blood wretch, And the second AP, I'm gonna attack you with my inhuman claws.
All right, punching again. Oh, I only got a 2.
Woo. And you got a 12, so that makes you defense 5. You go to 17. I'm melee 6, so I go to an 8. So I gotta try and cheat to win here. Although I don't think I can. With my current hands, I have no way of hitting you.
So with both of us out of models, it's time to shuffle up our decks, draw up to 6 cards, and then flip for initiative again.
All right, I get to draw 1. Well, that's a good card. And then we get to flip now to see who is going first for initiative. 5.
3.
Whoa, it's me! All right, so I get to go first. I am going to activate this Blood Wretch right here. He's going to use his tactical action, the Rage Builds. For the rest of his activation, the model's attacks deal +1 damage, and when this model deals damage with an attack, it can draw 2 cards and discard 1. And my second activation, I am going to try and melee you. So here we go. Let's see if I can hit you.
Don't melee me.
Oh, that's not a good card.
That's a better than that card.
Yep.
I'm at an 8 right now.
I'm at a 14 now, because that's the best I can do. So 14, can you beat it? Needs 50. A 9 or better. Oh, and I miss. Well, in this case, the best tactical action would have probably just been to hit you again, but I didn't do that, so now it's over to you.
I'm gonna punch back.
Okay,
sounds good. Doesn't like getting punched, so.
Which one, lefty or righty? You wanna punch the one that's been activated or the one that hasn't been activated?
The one that hasn't been activated.
Probably a wise move. All right, so.
Let's be extra tactical.
I'm defense 6.
All right, I'm melee 5.
The good thing is I know all the good cards are still in this deck, but no, they're not. Well,
13's good.
I literally 18. There's no way for me to stop that. So go ahead and flip some damage. Is it moderate, weak, or severe?
Low.
Weak. So how much is 2 weak damage? 2 damage. All right, my Blood Wretch takes it for 2. He's got 3 left. All right, swing on this fellow one more time. See what you get.
Chicken.
Do I get a good card? I don't. All right, hit me again.
Levinsky's. I'm at 16. That's higher.
I can't beat it. Moderate, damage. Weak, or severe?
Moderate. That's going to be 3.
And I'm dead. And that's game.
Punch.
Subdues the Blood Wretch.
That's why you wear gloves.
And because you killed me, that's going to end the round. All right, so now our third and final encounter in this portion of the Let's Play is going to be focused primarily on adding sort of the more advanced cards, things like charging, so some of our other advanced combat maneuvers, pulses, aura effects, conditions, interacts, and the additional rules that you can do outside of just sort of moving and swinging on each other and activating models.
And triggers and stuff.
That's right. This one's called Into the Night, and Angel Eyes, a mysterious gun-toting Neverborn, has broken into the asylum and come to the aid of the inmates and is trying to rescue them and get them outside. So let's take a look at Into the Night. We'll set it up and we'll take you through the rules for this section of the Let's Play. And here we go, encounter 3, Into the Night. The asylum has been breached, and our mysterious rifle-wielding Nephilim has come to the aid of the inmates. Don't let her get away. So in this game, the Nephilim player, me, will get to use Angel Eyes right here, mercenary with a rifle, and 2 Blood Wretches, and he'll be taking on Dr. Grimwell. He's been called out to the grounds to back up his 2 orderlies and try and subdue the inmates. Once again, we'll be playing on an 18-inch table with some terrain. We basically moved a bit further on from the fountain as reinforcements have been called in. So new rules. Angel Eyes and Dr. Grimwell are the leaders of their respective crews, so it's time to get serious and introduce some more advanced concepts. Now, charging. Charge is an action that every model has access to, even though it's not printed in their stat card, much like walk action, which we learned about last time. So it's right next to the walk action on the front right here, and it's a 2 action. It takes both of your actions to do. It usually gives you a little bit of extra movement. Now, if you have a dash instead of a number here, you cannot do the charge action. When you charge, you move in a straight line up to a number of inches equal to your charge stat, and must end engaged with the enemy, because you can pre-measure. There's no doing this without being engaged. Then you get to perform 2 attack actions with 1 AP cost against the target, and they have to have the melee icon as well. And that's a single target. You don't spend any more AP to do that. Any model that's not, a model may not charge if it's already engaged. So if you start in base to base with somebody, you can't break off because you're basically already put together. So for instance, if you wanted to charge this Blood Wretch with your
Orderly,
you'd be 7 inches away. So you're able to do it.
And basically I could end my charge within 1 inch of you.
You sure could.
And I could charge sort of like other any direction, other lines, as long as it's a straight line.
Yep, has to be a straight line. Yep. But you can prevent charges by things like this. So if you can see me around this corner, but you're over here, there is no way for you to charge in a straight line. Hopefully, if I was back a little bit further, so let's say you're there, that would end you within 1 inch of me. So you can prevent charges sometimes, either by model placement, so you could have a guy right here preventing a charge because you couldn't charge past this scenery. Now, because it does have to be a straight line, you can't go in circles to have a charge. Likewise, let's say you could draw a line of sight over here because you can see through that grill. He can see this guy, but he can't charge him because he can't get within an inch going through that impassable terrain. Next up, we have positive and negative twist. Now, positive twist is a plus symbol, and it's a modifier that's applied when a model flips a card. For each plus, you flip an additional card, and a model with one or more plus can choose which card it's using to discard the rest. So for instance, if I gain a plus from my frenzied charge ability, whenever I charge, I get plus flips to any attacks it generates due to the charge action. So when I attack on the charge, my blood wretches flip two cards. I get a six and a two here. I would obviously choose the six because it's the higher of the two cards and discard the two. So it would go on the top of the stack. And that would be the card I would select. Now, negative twists can be applied whenever model flips a card. And for each negative, you'd flip a card, and you must choose the lowest. Now, in this case, I didn't have to choose a six. If there was a better reason for me to get the two, I could pick it if I want to. In this case, flipping two cards with a negative twist, I have a nine and a five. I'm forced to take the five. The other thing is, too, you may not cheat fate when you have a negative twist. So there is no way for you to insert a better card when you have a negative. Negatives can be done by lots of different things. Terrain very often brings it out. Special abilities and stuff too. But when you have a negative, it's super hard for you to win a duel unless you flip a bunch of really high cards out of your deck. And now we're gonna bring in accuracy modifiers. Now, when you have a melee attack, a shooting attack, whatever kind of attack you're doing against somebody that's opposed, you get a modifier to your damage flip based on the difference between your attack and their defense flip. So sometimes, even if you're gonna lose, it's worth cheating something high, because the closer you are to tied, the worse it is. So if you tie the person's attack flip, they get a double negative to their defense, for, to their attack, their damage flip.
So Chris here would flip. Normally you flip one card for damage.
Yep, that would be severe.
And for every negative, you flip an extra card. So that's
moderate
one negative,
now.
And this would be two negatives, right?
So now he'd have two high cards there, but he'd be forced to take the moderate and discard these two because he was at double negative and there'd be no way for him to cheat with a negative twist. And finally, we have triggers. So a model's triggers will generally appear below, and that's whenever there's an attack with a special ability. So if we look at my blood wretches, they have no triggers. If we look at your orderlies, I don't think they have any triggers either. Nope, but if we look at Angel Eyes, she has one called Hide in the Shadows. So if your attack flip, if the final one that you pick, the final card that you decide you're gonna use, has the suit associated with a trigger, it'll say when it happens, and there'll be an effect that you can pull off of it as well. So if Angel Eyes uses her teeth and blackened claws, and flips a mask, if she succeeds in the attack, she can move 3 inches afterwards, which is super handy to get her out of the way or have her go and hide and stuff like that. Now, when she uses her rifle, she has that ability as well with a mask. If she gets a ram, though, she has critical strike. When damaging the target, the attack gets +1 damage for every ram in the final duel total. So if she hits you with a ram, her damage grid goes from 2-3-4 to 3-4-5. You don't have to take a trigger if you don't want to, but you do have to declare it at the time that it's decided to be used. Now, finally, we have engagement range. Any attacks with the claw symbol in its range is a close combat attack, and that model becomes engaged if it's inside that distance. Two models are engaged if they have line of sight to each other, and at least one of the two has a melee attack that's in range of the other one. You can tell if attack is a projectile attack or a gun attack based on the symbol. So it's a little gun symbol if it's projectile, like a shoot. It's a little claw attack if it's melee. So for instance, Angel Eyes card. See her teeth and blackened claws. They have a claw symbol. There's a gun symbol on her rifle. So she has a range of one, which means if she's within 1 inch of this orderly, he is engaged and so is she. Now, the Dr. Grimwell, what's the range on his weapon?
He has a range 2 weapon, actually.
There you go. So now, right now, he is not engaged by the Blood Wretch, but he is engaging it. So the Blood Wretch can't attempt to get free because of that range on that chainsaw. But Grimwell himself could just keep moving because he's not engaged by anybody else. So it can be very handy. I think range of your melee attack might be one of the most powerful abilities in the game because it locks down other models. And that's important is disengaging strikes. Now, let's say that this Blood Wretch was here and he wanted to try and get away. As soon as he declared that he was going to do it, Grimwell would get to make a melee attack against him for free. Now, if that hits, it does no damage, but the Blood Wretch wastes his AP and doesn't actually move. If the Blood Wretch, for whatever reason, wins the duel total for cheating in, as a regular attack duel, he can then spend that AP and move. Regardless of the outcome, the AP is spent as soon as it's declared, and you can lose action points trying to disengage, which makes that chainsaw super handy for locking down the movement of models. We're going to bring in pulses. A pulse is denoted by this little guy screaming with lightning shooting out of the sides of him symbol. This simply means that all models in a certain area effect are affected. So, for instance, Angel Eyes has black blood. Whenever she's damaged, all models within 1 inch of her take 1 damage because her blood is poisonous. So you would measure that 1 inch range. If that orderly hit her and did damage, he would take a damage back from being splayed by black blood. Now your friendly models will take it too. So a Blood Wretch in range would take it. Now black blood has a special rule where Nephilim models, so my Scion, is immune to it. It only does the damage to non-Nephilim miniatures, models with that keyword. So if you look at my... Sorry, models without black blood is what it is. So other models with black blood, so the Scion also has black blood, he would not take that damage. And conveniently, the Blood Wretches have a thing called Thick Hide. They just ignore damage from pulses in general. So my guys are immune to her damaging from splashing out the blood, but anyone in Grimwald's gang will take damage if they're within an inch when she gets hit. Again, a reason Grimwald's 2-inch engagement range becomes really handy. He can hit with a chainsaw and not get covered in poisonous acid blood. Now, finally, we have zero actions. Now, zero actions are an action that's usually a tactical action, but sometimes not. So for instance, Angel Eyes sidearm, and they can be used once per turn, but they don't cost any AP. So she has a little handgun that she can just fire once for free every round without any AP, which can make her really maneuverable. It's only got a 6-inch range, but she can move twice up to, I think, 5 per move. Yep, so she can move 10 inches and still fire a gun with her little snapshot from that. Do you have any zero actions that Grimwald does?
He does not.
Nope, no zero actions? Okay. No. Maybe Heartsbane does later on. But zero actions are usually just an action that doesn't cost any AP, but the only caveat is you can only use one of your zero actions each round. This encounter, the first player to kill the opposing leader, so Angel Eyes or Grimwell, will be the one that wins the game. So we will flip right now, see who flips higher to see who sets up first. We'll set up 6 inches on, I get an 11. You get a 6, so I'll force you to set up your gang first within 6 of your edge, and we'll get started. All right, so we are deployed. Chris deployed first, putting down an orderly to sneak through this fountain, this little park. Grimwald right in the middle, and then the other orderly on the flank. I got to deploy second, which means I deployed Angel Eyes back in this corner with a nice line of fire with a chainsaw.
Is she a sniper?
She might be. And then we got the two Blood Wretches to basically run interference while I try and shoot Grimwald to death. Deployed, we're going to draw some hands, so drop to 6, then we'll flip for initiative and see who's going first. All right, hands are drawn. Let's see who's getting to go first. Initiative flip.
A draw.
Oh, it's all you, son.
Good guess.
So you can pick a model. And then you get to activate first. So just like last round, it's activation by activation. Picking a model that gets to move. 2 AP for this orderly. He can do any of the new actions, like charge, his tactical actions, or whatever.
He's just gonna walk probably twice. So 6. Right. He's gonna walk around here.
So first walk,
and
second
he's
walk.
He's gonna walk right behind the fence here.
All right, hiding some cover. We're gonna activate out Angel Eyes, and we're gonna see what this rifle can do, because she sees a guy with a chainsaw, and she's not down with that. So she has a bunch of actions. The most important of which is her snapshot rifle. She is going to take a shot, shoot 6, range 14, which means I am well within range. This is 8. You need to grab your gauge, make sure I'm within 6.
6 more?
Yeah, 6 more. Oh yeah, got it. So we are in range, and that means we will take a shot. I am shoot 6 with my rifle, and it does have both hide in the shadows and the other one, which is if I get a ram, a critical strike. So let's see who's hitting first.
Defense 6. So 10.
I get a total of 15. So you can cheat. Now remember, we do have positive and negative twists in play here. So even just cheating it higher can be handy.
I'm gonna try to make you miss 17.
17 total. All right, well, I am gonna cheat with a 13 of rams. That'll make it a 19, which is a difference of 2. Now, if you remember on the chart, a difference of 2, 1 to 5, means a negative flip. But because I put a ram in the total, I get a trigger, and that trigger is critical strike. So after damaging, sorry, when damaging, I get +1 damage for every ram in the final total. So I become 3, 4, 5 damage. Oof. But I do have to flip 2 cards here and pick the lowest. Let's see if I get weak, moderate, or severe. That's gonna be a weak, but that is still 3 damage. All right, 3 damage off Grimwald. He's got 6 left from his total of 9. We're just gonna shoot him again. Might as well try. I get a 1 is my total.
16.
16, that's not good. Well, let's go and make it a 19 again.
Holy moly. You know what, let's make this game interesting. Red Joker.
Oh, out comes the red joker. You that missed. Puts you at 20. 20. All right, so I am going to miss. Now, I do not successfully hit, so I didn't succeed, which means I do not get to get my trigger. I will, however, use my zero action and shoot my holdout pistol into this orderly. All right, so with a quick shot, the shoot value of the sidearm is not super high. It's only, oh, it's six as well, never mind. So she's going to flip a 3, which puts her at 9 against the orderly. You will flip a 1, which I'm puts you at a 6, so you can try and cheat to win.
I'll go up to a 10.
10 to my 9. I will cheat it higher with an 8 to make it a 14. And that is a 10 to 14 difference of 4, so 1 to 4, negative flip. It has 2, 2, 3 as a damage flip. So we get 1, which is weak. And that's going to be 2 damage. Turn Angel Eyes there. And that finishes her off. So now it's over to you. You can activate another model. You've got your two orderlies, your orderly and Dr. Grimwell left.
This orderly is going to spend his whole turn just performing some emergency surgery on Dr. Grimwell.
On Grimmy, okay.
He's going to heal him for 2.
Sounds good. Only got 1 damage on him, so it's back over to me. Blood Arch is going to go. He's going to move in his 6 inches for his first AP. And he's going to take a swing on your orderly. Within an inch, I'm actually going to back up a little bit here because I don't want to necessarily get charged by Grimwell. Not that I think he can't charge me because he does have a crazy charge range, but let's see what we can do here. So, I try and hit you with my first AP. Charging in. So, I have a plus flip because of my furious charge. That's right. So, I get 7 as my highest.
I'm at a 7 total.
Okay, so I get a 13.
I'm going to cheat. Give myself a 14.
A 14, all right. So you're at 14 right now total. I don't think I can do anything exciting here, so I'm just gonna take my second charge attack. Second charge attack's red joker.
Oof. Flipping, 10.
Positive just again, so you get a 10 to my total of 20. Wanna cheat?
No, that's okay.
Okay, so I can't get any higher than that. I will make that a, actually there's no trigger, so it doesn't even really matter. So 10 to 20 is just a straight flip, which means I can cheat it. That's gonna be weak, but I will cheat it to a severe.
Woo.
And make that a total of 5 damage.
Okay.
5 damage, managed to knock out the orderly. Now Blood Rush is done. Mr. Grimwell is nimble, so which gives him a free action point to move each turn.
Yep, so he's at the walk.
Okay.
So he's just gonna, up to here, and then he's going to charge a 7 and a reach of 2.
Oh my goodness.
9. So I think right now I'm kind of blocked, so I'm going to have to probably chop some of these guys away.
Yeah, because you have to go into a straight line, which would put you there.
Over to here then.
Yeah, you're going to go into him.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're an activated guy. Looks charge. Good, and that's a charge. Okay, so for 2 AP, he's charged into that unactivated Blood Wretch. He's going to swing on him with his chainsaw.
Skull saw.
All right, what's your defense, or what's your melee?
6.
All right, my defense is 6 as well, so let's see who gets the flip. 15 total, and you can try and cheat.
I will go up to a 19.
Ooh, 19 to 15, it's a difference of 4, so negative flip, I will keep it.
These 2 cards.
That's Black Joker.
Wow.
So Black Joker will say directly on the card what it does. If you flip a Black Joker and a damage flip, 0 damage. Charge attack though, so you get to go again. Yep. 6 against 6, 4 to 3, so I'm currently losing. I'll make mine a 12.
And he misses.
All right. So I'm engaged, meaning I cannot charge, but I can move in and start trying to fight you. So I'm going to do so. Hang out right there with my first AP. Second AP, I'll swing on you. So melee attack, 6 against your defense of?
6.
All right, well, I get a total of 14.
16,
gonna miss. That will end the turn. So we're going to unturn all our cards here. And we now have new turn, so we're going to shuffle our discard piles into our decks and then drop our new hands and get started for new initiative flip. So we have drawn new hands, so flipping for initiative. Let's see who's going first. That's 6. That's an 8. So it's going to be you, Mr. Grimwell. What would you like to do?
He's
going to
nimble his way in over here.
Okay, so he's staying in melee. Staying within an inch of me. He can move freely while he's engaged, but he's now within 2 inches of Angel Eyes. He's going to try and shoot. Here we go.
Boom.
12.
18 total.
20 with a red joker.
Okay, then.
All right, well, that's not going to happen.
I'm
and
not going to try and
next
shoot
one. I get a 9 total.
10.
10. So I have to cheat first. Mm-hmm. I'm going to cheat it with an 11, make that a 17.
Okay, I might as well try and hit you here. So I'm going to go up to an 18.
18, all right. Well, you hit me once, difference of one, which means it's a negative flip. So two, that's pick right. The lowest.
Gonna be low,
weak and weak. That does make my black blood spray, whoops, but you're not within an inch, so you take no damage. Now it's over to me. So we are just going to, I can just charge. So this fellow right here is gonna charge in, whoop, going into base two. We're gonna charge in like this, actually. Yeah. Plus flips because it's a charge attack, so let's see if we hit you. That's going to be two pick the highest. We get a 10, 16 with our teeth and black and claws.
19.
You get a 19, that'll miss. We'll go again with our second charge attack. Ooh, 5 and 1, that's 11. Not good
enough, 12, you can cheat.
Yeah, I can tie you.
Dig deep.
Dig deep. What do you got?
Boom.
Oh, and he wins 13 and dime, yeah. Seriously. Over to you. You've got Mr. Orderly who can go. He's a bit far away, but he can start legging it.
Yeah, he's definitely too far to charge, so he's just going to walk twice.
Okay,
so
walking six. Twice, making himself relevant.
Yeah, into the game again, and might as well just
go follow the doc. Yep, so you're engaged. All right, we're going to activate this fella. He is going to use his one action for the rage builds, and then he's going to try and attack you. So I get plus one damage, my ideal damage. Melee six against your defensive six. So let's see if I hit you.
Okay.
I got a 18. Can you do it?
Nope.
Okay, so 18, can you make it better?
Nope.
Okay, 18, well, to, maybe, yeah. 18 to 12, this is a difference of 6, which in a difference of 6 or more is a straight flip, so it's one card and I can cheat it, but that's going to be moderate, and moderate right now with my plus 1 will be 4 damage. I do get to draw 2 cards and then discard 1. We'll discard that one. Activation is over, so it's all on to Angel Eyes. She is engaged, so she can't charge. Oh, goodness, what do we want to do? We can't shoot. All of our things are guns. So really, the best bet I have here is to either break off and hope my Blood Wretches can finish you off, or at least they slow you down enough to kill you. Or I try and kill you in melee, but I only get one attack. Left. I have one attack, and I have six left. You have 4 health left, right? I don't really have a good ability here. But I think what I'm going to do is move, but move in such a way that everybody's nearby, staying within 2 of you, and then melee Dr. Grimwell. Yeah, because if you hit me, then you will also take damage. All right, so we're going to swing on Mr. Grimwell, see if we hit him. I'm melee 6 with my blackened teeth and claws.
I'm 6.
I get a 2, 17. So 17. I will make it also a 17.
Alrighty, that's a double negative, right?
It's a double negative, so it's 3 pick the lowest. 1, 2,
Black Joker.
3. It's going to be weak, but weak is still going to be at least 2 damage. Hitting the shadows will trigger off that mask, which means I can move 3 inches. I have to stay inside your melee engagement, though. I'm just gonna stay where I am. Get initiative, this could all go very well. If I don't get initiative, it's not gonna go very well. So we're gonna shuffle, draw new hands, and start the next turn. Hands are drawn, let's see who's going first. Big initiative flip, 12.
Ooh.
Oh, it's all Nephilim all the time. So now, hilariously, my Blood Wretches actually have a better damage track, I'm pretty sure, than she does. So I'm gonna have to try and kill you with one of them. Now, you have 4 damage, you said?
I only got 2 left now because you poked me with Angel Eyes.
I'm not going to bother with the Rage Builds then. I'm just going to try and hit you twice. Yep. So let's do it. We're going to activate this Blood Wretch right here, and he's going to try and punk Mr. Grimwell.
Okay,
so first attack, 6 against 6.
8. It's huge.
That's going to be a 12. What do you got? 12, that's going to be better than 12.
17.
17, can't hit that, so I'm not going to even try. We're going to go again.
Let's see if the deck gods are on my side. Oh, that's huge.
All right, so I'm losing.
Oh, God.
Let's make it a 16. Can you do it? Nope, but you can make it worse.
That's my highest card.
That's your highest card, yeah. Okay. So I have a damage of minimum track 2.
Yep.
Right now it's 16 to your 13, so 2 pick the lowest. Need a black joker here. No, it's moderate. It's going to be 3 damage. That's going to kill Grimwell. And we're going to end encounter number 3 into the night as we make off into the darkness. All right, so there you have it, the first half of Let's Play Malifaux. We went through encounters 1, 2, and 3 from the Quick Start rules in the Malifaux 2nd Edition Starter Set. Now, if you tune in to our next Let's Play, it'll be in 2 weeks. You'll be able to see the encounters 4 and 5, and that's The Ritual, where Dr. Grimwell, Nurse Heartsbane, and the two orderlies basically leave the asylum and try and hunt down the up-to-no-good Neverborn who are out there performing some kind of ritual in the dark. And then the final one, Secret Assassin, in which case, basically, we have the Neverborn and the guild's final showdown out in the wilds to basically see who's going to get them back in their cages or if they're going to escape into the night and be free. So that'll take us through into the final sort of section. We're going to some more advanced rules to the game. I hope you enjoyed this. You can tune in next time for our next Malifaux Let's Play. It'll be 2 Fridays from now. So not next Friday, the Friday after. So thanks, Chris, for coming in. Help me out.
No problem, man.
We'll see you guys next time for the Let's Play. Till then, I'm Ash. This is Chris. I'm Brandon.